Hi, welcome to ACE Teachers Online, a series of online tutorials for students. My name is Rosy, and today we're looking at friction. Friction is the force that resists motion between surfaces that are in contact with each other. Friction acts along the boundary between the contacting surfaces, and it is due to tiny irregularities or roughness in the contacting surfaces. So there are two types of friction. Firstly, we have kinetic friction, which exists when the two surfaces are moving relative to each other. So kinetic friction is given by the formula friction is equal to mu kn. So n is the normal reaction force between the contacting surfaces, and mu k is the coefficient of kinetic friction. Now, this value depends on the nature of the contacting surfaces. For example, the mu k for a wooden object moving across a wooden floor will be different to that of a wooden object moving across, let's say, a metal floor. On the other hand, we have static friction. Like the name suggests, static friction exists when the two surfaces are not moving relative to each other, i.e. they are stationary. So static friction can be thought of as the grip between contacting surfaces, such that when a driving force is applied parallel to the boundary between the two surfaces, the static friction increases in order to cancel out that driving force and maintain an F net of zero. So as we know from Newton's first law, if the F net is zero, then there will be no change in the motion of the object, i.e. that object will remain stationary. Now, as the driving force being applied to the object increases, the static friction also increases until it reaches a point where the driving force overcomes the static friction. And at this point, the forces acting on the object are no longer balanced. The object begins to move and kinetic friction takes over. So it's important to note that the static friction only exists when a driving force is being applied, and mathematically, the static friction can be expressed as an inequality, where the static friction is less than or equal to mu Sn. So mu S is the coefficient of static friction, and like mu K, it depends on the nature of the contacting surfaces. Again, N is our normal reaction force. There are two other important things to note regarding friction. The first is that for two given surfaces, the mu S is usually greater than the mu K, reflecting the fact that it is more difficult to initiate motion of an object than it is to keep that object moving. Secondly, the kinetic friction and the maximum value of static friction are both proportional to the normal reaction force between the two surfaces. Now, as we know, the normal reaction force is equal and opposite to the weight force, or more specifically, the component of weight force perpendicular to the boundary between the two surfaces. So this means that heavier objects tend to experience more friction than lighter objects on that same surface. In this question, we have a wooden box being moved up a wooden slope. Now, we were given the coefficients of static and the coefficients of kinetic friction in the question, and I've just transcribed these down here. So the first thing we should do in this question and for every other kinematics question is to draw a free body diagram showing all of the forces acting on our object. And this free body diagram is shown here. So the next thing we do is to resolve the forces into two perpendicular axes. And in this case, we're going to resolve the forces into components that are parallel to the slope and perpendicular to the slope. So acting parallel to the slope, we have our driving force, or FD, which is going up, and opposing that, we have a friction force. So in the first part of this question, the box is not moving, and so static friction is at play. In addition, we have the component of our weight force that's acting parallel to the slope. And using simple trigonometry, we can see that this component of weight parallel to the slope is given by mg sine. So then we know that since the box is not moving, the forces acting up the slope are equal and opposite to those acting down the slope, which means that we can create a force equation for the forces parallel to the slope. Now we can do a similar thing for the forces acting perpendicular to the slope. We have an upwards normal reaction force, and we also have a downwards force, which is essentially the component of our weight force that is acting perpendicular to the slope. So again, using simple trigonometry, we can see that that's mg cos theta. Again, the forces acting perpendicular to the slope are equal and opposite, i.e. net force in the perpendicular direction is zero. So now I have these two equations which I can use to solve the question. Now, in order to find the threshold mass of the box that Billy is able to move, we need to consider what happens when the maximum driving force, i.e. 100 newtons, is applied. In this case, the static friction will be the maximum threshold value that has to be overcome in order for the box to start moving. So, substituting the known values into equation one, we get when our static friction is equal to the maximum threshold value, we get the static friction is equal to the coefficient of static friction multiplied by the normal reaction force. Now we see from equation two that the normal reaction force is equal to mg cos 30. Now, substituting this value for friction back into equation one, after substituting these values of the driving force and the static friction when this maximum driving force is being applied to the box, we can calculate the value of m, i.e. the mass of the box, as 12 kilograms. So now moving on to part B, the box is now moving, which means that the forces acting on the box are unbalanced and kinetic friction is now at play. So again, if we consider the forces acting on the box parallel to the slope, we see that there is a net force going in the upwards direction, and that is the result of the interaction of the driving force, which remains at 100 newtons, the kinetic friction, as well as the component of the gravitational weight force that's parallel to the slope. So, like I said before, the friction is now the kinetic friction, and so we can calculate that using our coefficient of kinetic friction. Now, substituting this value of kinetic friction into our equation for F net, we get so we know from Newton's second law that F net is equal to ma. Since we know the mass of our box, we can then calculate its acceleration. To calculate the final velocity of the box after 10 seconds, we can use the equation v is equal to u plus at. Since the box was stationary initially, u is equal to zero. So here we have a final velocity of 17 meters per second. Remember, velocity is a vector, therefore it requires a direction, and in this case, that direction is up the slope. In this question, we introduce the concepts of kinetic and static friction. This question is unique in that it combines the concept of forces on an inclined plane with friction, and therefore it's important to remember that we must first resolve all of the forces acting on the object into a component that is parallel to the slope and into a component that's perpendicular to the slope before we proceed with our equations.
Thanks for watching this video. For more information, look at our website down below and keep tuned for more ACE Teachers Online.